Let's talk about activism for a moment.
Sure.
And the reason I say that is because there's a widespread assumption about what activism is. At the same time, there's an understanding that every firm in the business of activism practices it differently. Mm-hmm. So what is Sevian's brand of activism exactly?
Well, I'll tell you, actually, when we started this strategy 20 years ago, we hadn't even heard about activism, and now we're supposedly the biggest activist investor in Europe. Our activism is rather an engaged shareholder.
What does that mean?
Well, that means that we're taking large stakes in a few companies. We make maybe two investments per year, typically keep the investments for, say, 3-7 years, sometimes 10 years. And what we do is we look at companies that are sound good companies in sound good industries, but where the company's underperforming to where it could and should be, where it's underperforming its peers. And then we're asking ourselves, can we invest in this company and be a steward in making sure that this company is going to be a much better company mm-hmm. 5 years from now than it is today?
So would you say that you're a take-no-prisoners kind of activist, like, let's say, a Carl Icahn, or perhaps a Jeff Smith from Starboard, or when he chooses to do it, a Dan Loeb or a Bill Ackman?
Well, I think our environment is quite different here in Europe, and our style is different. Over these 20 years, we've been on board on the vast majority of our companies. That's how we typically engage as a shareholder. We've never had to do a proxy fight. We've entered the board anyway. So we're doing in more of a constructivist way. But we are pursuing change, and that is a similarity. We are pursuing change of a company because the company is not performing to where it should be, and therefore we want to make sure that the strategies and the structures and the teams are the right ones for the future.
So you say no proxy fight. Is that because you say you haven't needed to?
Correct.
But is that to say that you would?
We haven't been in that situation yet, and I don't think we're going to be there. I think it's very clear that what we're doing is something that is good for the company we invest in. It's good for not just for us, but for all stakeholders. We're not asking the question, what should we do with this company over the next half year to make the price go up? We're thinking about how do we make this company more valuable? And the way to make it more valuable is to make it more competitive so that it has the right products, get the right customers, so it makes better profits, better cash flows. And by doing that, we're creating value not just for us, but for all the shareholders and all the stakeholders.
You mentioned that European activism and the nature of activism in Europe is different from what people in the States might be used to. What is the difference? And why is it
different? Well, we have different sorts of activism in Europe as well. But I think if I look at the American space in activism and the legacy, it came a lot from the hedge fund side, sort of the trading side, or from the raiders side. And that is coming in and being pretty aggressive, going for short-term measures, not necessarily bad, but short-term measures that would be like
stock buybacks, for example.
This would be a classic one. Whereas we're coming from more the private equity side, where we're sort of thinking about the whole company and thinking about how do we run the operations of the company better, the strategy of the company better, and creating value that way.
So let's take an example. Mm-hmm. ThyssenKrupp.
Yeah.
Gigantic German industrial company.
Yes.
You've been in that stock for 4.5 years, roughly?
Correct. Yeah, correct.
What kind of impact do you think you've had thus far?
Well, I think ThyssenKrupp is to put the perspective, ThyssenKrupp is a giant transformation. ThyssenKrupp is a very well-known company in Germany. It's one of the largest companies, employs about 150,000 people. It's an important company.
And they're in all kinds of businesses, right? Elevators, steel, car parts.
Correct. It's sort of built out over 100 years into a vast conglomerate with many, many different businesses. Many of them very good businesses, but together the structure of the company is way too complicated, and that complexity is hampering the business from thriving.
So you have recently called for, effectively, a breakup of this company.
Yes, we think it's not the right thing for a company to combine and try and find synergies between, on the one hand, elevators and submarine production, or building cement factories and making auto components, which is it's just in this kind of fast-moving world where you have to be really good at what you do. If you're creating complexities, you're just making it difficult for the businesses to thrive and grow.
So if complexity is a hindrance, mm-hmm. one has to draw the conclusion that it's depressing the stock value. Some of the parts, ThyssenKrupp has a market cap of what? just shy of 16 billion euros today.
Correct.
What should it be worth?
It should be worth the double. I mean,
double.
Yeah, put it this way. If the margin targets were met that management put up 4 years ago, the value of the business would be 50 billion and not 25. Sorry, it would be 50 euros per share rather than 25 today. But I think the important thing here is not that it's breaking up the company in order to short-term lift the share price. This is about making sure that, you know, thinking about what management needs to do and the board needs to do is sort of think about the various components of the business and think about the elevator business, the auto component business, and ask themselves the question, how do we make sure that this business is in the right structure and is sort of free to move ahead?
So as you probably know, well, as you surely know, the company is holding its annual general meeting today.
Sure.
And the CEO, Heinrich Hiesinger, is in Handelsblatt rejecting your proposals, your criticism, and saying he needs more time. What do you say?
No, I think there's been a lot of time already. Mr. Hiesinger has been on board and run this company
for seven years.
Clear. The direction the company is taking is to restructure. There's an agreement between ThyssenKrupp and Tata to combine their two steel entities into one, and that would be a starting point of a separation. Actually, Mr. Hiesinger came out in the press this morning indicating that there will be a strategic review of the company during the spring. And I think that's good news.
So how much more time do you give him?
Well, I expect that this strategic review will lead to what is in German called a Befreiungsschlag, basically a very thorough review that will lead to a very thorough change.
And if he doesn't do what you want?
Well, I think this is what we're looking at now during the spring, to have this work done, and we will participate in that work. We have a representative on the board, and we'll have a dialogue, continued dialogue with.
But you know what I'm getting at here, given the fact that he's already been at it for 7 years. If he doesn't give you what you want, is the next step to campaign for his ouster?
No, I think what we're saying here is that we're saying that the strategy that has been pursued so far has not really worked out. See, these targets were put out 4 or 5 years ago to move the margins of the industrial business from 3.5% to where the competitors are, about 6-7%.
They're not there.
They're not there. They're still at half that level. That means something is not working, and the root cause of that problem is the structure of the group.
You seem to have infinite patience.
Well, I think what we have is a combination of patience and impatience, and I think that's what we need to have.
You made a lot of money.
I tell you, you know, it's similar to similarities with Volvo, the trucking manufacturer.
I was just about to get there.
Yeah, okay.
But by which you mean what? Because you were in Volvo.
Yeah.
You had taken an activist position.
Yeah.
Geely came along. You sold your interest in Volvo. You made a lot of money. What do you do with that capital?
Well, first, let me just back one step,
sure,
though. We invested in Volvo 10 years ago, and the first 3-4 years were difficult to get our thoughts through. And then we managed to influence the strategy, make changes to the management team and the board, and we could support the company in doing a complete change from being one of the laggards in their industry to being one of the best. So taking the margin from 4% to close to 10%. And we sort of doubled our stake 4 years ago, became the largest shareholder, and now we sold our stake to Geely.
So,
and that money,
that's a good illustration. Now, as I say, what do you do with the capital?
That capital will invest in new situations.
Well, what appeals to you? Because, you know, I'm not suggesting that Sevian strikes heart in the fear of every CEO across Europe, but people do want to know where you're likely to prospect next. Are you looking at retail? Are you looking at industrials? Are you looking at auto parts like Continental, for example? Are you looking at financial services? Give us a sense of what we are looking at
all those industries that you talked about. But of course, we won't talk about exactly what company we'll invest in. But what I can tell you is that when we invest in a company, we've typically looked at that company for many, many years. So we invested in Ericsson last year. We'd have followed Ericsson for 10 years. And what we do is we have a team of 30 investment professionals that make maybe 2 investments per year, which means we can travel the globe and meet with the competitors of the company, suppliers, customers, and what have you.
There's a sense in the United States that the easy money in activism has been made, right? Fewer and fewer companies with bad management, sclerotic boards, flawed strategies, unwieldy structures. How do you compare that with the activist opportunity in Europe?
I've never thought about this as easy money, to be honest. I think this is a very engaged strategy, and going into companies, joining boards of companies, and making sure that they perform well, that they're going to be better companies. That's very hard work. It takes a lot of preparation. Because we design a change plan before we enter a company, before we buy a single share in a company. And then it takes a lot of hard work in a collegial manner with the other board members of a company to make it a better company. It's not an easy... I've never seen the easy money.